Welcome back. Off the Record starts right now.
On the OTR panel this week, we have Kathy Barks Hoffman and Rick Pluta, along with Chris Kristoff. Now here's the rundown. State lawmakers are back in town. Democrats propose free college tuition and internet gaming on the table. Later on, we'll be joined by the new president of the Michigan AFL-CIO, Carla Swift. All this and more coming up right now, Off the Record.
Getting the inside out. It's Off the Record with senior Capitol correspondent Tim Skubick and his Capitol Press Corps colleagues.
Production of Off the Record is made possible in part by a grant from Truscott Rossman, Michigan's only bipartisan strategic communications firm, serving statewide, national, and international clients from their offices in Lansing, Detroit, and Grand Rapids. TruscottRossman.com. By the Michigan Food and Beverage Association, in conjunction with the Michigan Business and Professional Association, working together for its members. Membership information on the web at mishbusiness.org. And by Hager Fox Heating and Air Conditioning Company, providing comfort to mid-Michigan homes and businesses since 1941. Hager Fox and Bryant, for whatever it takes, on the web at hagerfox.com.
And now this edition of Off the Record with Tim Skubick.
Thank you, Joe Donovan, and welcome to this wintry edition of Off the Record. Good to see all of you. Happy New Year again. There is going to be a surplus. The question is how much, and the better question is how do we spend it or do we spend it? Take a look.
After a month-long holiday break, state lawmakers return to this town, and what a difference a year makes. Last year, when everybody was welcoming everybody in, there was a huge deficit. Now, the welcome back includes a debate about a surplus. And the Senate Democratic leader says that surplus, it's a simple debate. Give it to the education folks.
Without question. Without question.
But the R's are going to say a lot of that money ought to go into the rainy day fund.
Yeah, and they like to say we can't afford to fund education. But you know what? We got to reject false choices.
Well, the House Republican Speaker does not rule out spending part of the surplus on education. He wants to squeeze first some savings out of the teacher retirement system, rather than pump the money directly into the K-12 per pupil budget.
I don't look at that as the best way to help the classroom. You have the school employee pension system, and that is strangling school districts' budgets. It's draining dollars from the classroom. So if we can reform that, use additional money to fund that, then potentially we can offer more relief than we could by just providing additional checks.
So let the games begin.
And indeed. All right, so the question is, will the schools get part of this surplus through whatever means, the K-12 foundation grant or through pension stuff?
I think that they're talking overall about $1 billion they're going to be carrying over, but the point is that the administration says, well, we already had counted on some of that money in this upcoming budget, so they say there's about $400 million that they have to play with. I do think that there's going to be some Republican push to put some of that into the rainy day fund and not, you know,
paying down long-term debt, and that's sort of the mantra on these things.
When they talk about pensions, newer teachers, already pay close to 4% towards their pensions. So, you know, they're already doing what they've asked state employees to do. What they're going to really want to do is go after teacher retiree health care. And I think that they're going to look very hard at trying to change that so that new teachers coming in do not have a guarantee of health care and retirement. They will give them extra money towards their 401k match instead.
Mm-hmm. The Republicans have now hit sort of a conundrum, I guess, that they've lost their budget crisis. And the pressure to go in and take drastic actions to do the sorts of things that they would still like to do, they're saying, to right the state's budget ship. But, you know, they know very well that people were unhappy about the cuts to K-12 schools. They were unhappy 15%. About what happened to universities and college tuitions. And it is an election year, at least for 110 House members.
Yeah. So education is going to get some.
Pressure is going to be huge to do something with them. It's been a long time since we've seen them fight over a surplus around here.
Yeah.
But if you recall, the fights over having a little too much money can be just as vicious as not having enough and having to cut. I mean, the lobbying for this will be just tremendous, mm-hmm. and especially from the education community, universities especially. The governor was actually asked about this at the auto show the other day from a student. He said, "Don't cut us anymore," and the governor said, "We're through cutting universities." Now the question is going to be, do they add any more money to that?
Well, we're hearing, you know, sort of the large umbrella term, invest, that we're going to be taking some of this money and we're going to invest it. But as you just pointed out, you know, there are a lot of people who are looking at, you know, where is the best place to invest it? Is it in, you know, some kind of urban development? Is it in environmental infrastructure fix up? You know, we've got problems with lots of with sewers in this state, and I could just go on and on and on and on. The road people are certainly going to be there, saying that we need to invest in roads and bridges.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you're not going to use the surplus for roads and bridges. I think what they're going to do, you know, the governor is very much into using dollars to, you know, to bring people down the road he wants to bring them down. So he has already talked about the fact that he would like to tie extra money for education to student achievement. And so the problem is, it's taking.
You mean I'd have to study?
Well, it's taking a long time for the legislature to come up with, you know, drafting how these proposals, how they're going to measure student achievement and things like that. But you're not going to see, I don't think, any, you know, just strict increase in the per pupil spending. They're going to tie it once again to different things they can measure.
Senator Roger Kahn makes a good point. Chairman, Republican chair of Senate Appropriations, he said there are two things sitting out there. One, the income tax rollback, okay, is going to be there. That's $170 million. And the feds are going to hit us with some cuts because they couldn't reach an agreement in Washington. He said those are all variables that you have to fit into this equation to determine how much money is actually there. So at the end of the day, we got basically chump change.
And there's also one other thing, which is that, we seem to be on the path to a slow economic recovery, but there are some variables out there. What you were just talking about, what was going on in Washington,
D.C. Let's try Greece for openers.
What's going on in Europe and what that means for the stability of the national economy, and so therefore the Michigan economy.
Well, one thing,
and so it's going to be there there's going to be some trepidation about counting on even the money that they have.
Keep in mind that a good part of this, the surplus, will be left over from the previous year. I mean, the forecasts are for a weaker economic showing this year and next year. Than last year.
Right.
So the argument of you don't spend what you don't have is also may ring true.
Some of that money was money that they simply didn't spend in the departments. Now, technically, that is a surplus, but it's leftover money, which is one-time leftover money.
It means that you don't have a structural surplus going forward, so you want to be careful how you spend it.
Yeah, I think the Senate Fiscal Agency estimated that revenue next year for the next budget year starting in October is going to be up only about 0.8%. So that's less than 1%. So, you know, it's not like you can say, we can count on having more money next year and more money the next year after that.
The Senate Democrats, do we agree, pretty much last year watched what was going on and they kind of muddled along. They had very little influence. But they start the new year, Chris, with a proposal which I think might have some gravitas, which is free college tuition.
Free college tuition. Up to $9,500 a year. A $1.8 billion program. They want to do it by eliminating some, so-called tax loopholes and cutting the cost of contracts. That's where it sort of falls into the government waste category. Everybody talks about getting rid of government waste, but when it comes to actually doing it, nobody's had that much success.
And the internet tax, sales tax, is also part of it.
Well, that's problematic.
Yep. Well, is this DOA? Is this DOA?
Well, I think that as a parent who's paying college tuition, you know, I mean, it has, you know, like you said, Bridge in the Center for Michigan has written this week just about how, our top universities are more expensive than most other public schools in other states. It's leaving kids with more debt, a lot more debt. And I think that, you know, if you are going to want to have more people go to college and have more of a knowledge economy, this is, you know, you're pricing college out of the reach of some people.
As a policy matter, it probably doesn't have a lot of traction. As a political matter, probably a great deal. What the Senate Democrats are hoping to do is throw something on the table that sometime later this year starts to change the conversation. We've seen it happen over the years with, for some reason I'm thinking back to in auto insurance rates. And there was a group out there with a petition drive to try and get it going. And they really wound up backing Republicans into a corner where they had to do something. And I think that Democrats seem to be trying to position themselves to, you know, do the same thing and try to force a question that works to their benefit.
This is something the Republicans cannot out of hand ignore.
Well, at one point, Governor Snyder talked about going back and giving the Michigan Promise Scholarship to those kids who were about the age of my 20-year-old, that it had been promised to them, and then it turned out to be a big fat lie because it went away. And the governor had come in and said, you know, that was unfair to take that away. We should try to make that up to those students.
Yeah.
So
and he left a lot of bad feeling with a lot of people
right.
out there.
And,
welcome,
you know,
to the real world.
Well, but if they're going to have a little bit more money, if they think they should invest more in education, I mean, that might be a place to start.
You could get to the $1.8 billion to pay for this if you wanted to. You can find it.
Well, I mean, they also can play off the governor saying that, you know, we don't like targeted incentives, that probably is room. And there's been studies to show that there are some questionable tax incentives and breaks that have been given out to businesses over the years, and they haven't followed through. Nobody's done anything to follow through on that and do something about it. So, you know, the idea, I think it's $34 million in, you know, expenditures and all this. Well, you know, most of that is not going to be touched. But if you're talking about trying to get $1.8 billion out of that pot, I mean, you could sit down with pencil and paper and do it.
But there's also, this is one of those issues. It becomes sort of emblematic, you know, the difference between what Democrats and Republicans believe about what government ought to be doing for people, and Democrats saying that government ought to be extending, you know, higher education and the means to pay for it to everyone.
Well,
and remember,
Republicans agree with that too.
We do have a governor who's talked about a P20 system, but no one's put the money up to do it. That Republicans are still saying that if you want to go and do this, students, you should bring some money to the table.
If you want to get more kids in this state and stop the brain drain, free college tuition is a way to do
families.
It.
Families. I mean, this is what happened in Kalamazoo.
Yes.
It attracted families. I mean, there's a pretty compelling
housing
argument
rates,
to make.
Housing
you
rates
could get
went
people
up.
Moving in here with that kind of a program. Free money? Are you kidding?
Yeah, I think the D's may be onto something. Or wouldn't it be something if he put it in the state of the state? This would be the bridge issue of this new year. I don't think he'll do it. But I think they have started the conversation. I talked to Randy Richardville, the Senate Republican leader. He said, we'll run the numbers. We'll take a look at it. I won't dismiss it out of hand. And he said, frankly, I went to the Senate Democrats and Ms. Whitmer last December and said, if you got some new ideas, bring them to me. Well, now he's got one.
That also suggests that Republicans are seeing the same public opinion data on this question that the Democrats are.
Well, education is a good political issue if you're running for re-election and even if you aren't. Let's pursue this in other points with our guest, the new president of the AFL-CIO, Ms. Swift. Carla Swift, our guest today, was recently elected president of the Michigan AFL-CIO. She comes to that post out of the leadership ranks of the UAW, and she was the state director of We Are the People, a coalition. She's a lifelong trade union member and is a former consultant to Wayne County government. Madam President, welcome to the program. Chris has got first question.
The coalition set forth a range of things you'd like to wish list, you'd like to see addressed this year. But what's at the top? We're talking here about education, free money for college. I mean, is that something that you guys can coalesce around and you think actually get pushed through the legislature?
Well, investment in education is a great choice. And in fact, just yesterday we rolled out a jobs plan for 2012 that includes one of the priorities is investing in schools and investing in kids, and I think this idea is great. Making education affordable and making Michigan more attractive to families is a great idea.
How do you convince enough Republicans in the legislature that it's so great an idea they should vote for it?
Well, I think it's clear that we need to prepare our children and our families to be ready for the workforces, for the jobs of the future, the high-tech jobs, the advanced energy jobs, and I think that moving the Republicans to a place where they are on a jobs agenda is what we should be doing right now.
Is Governor Snyder anti-union?
Um, You know, Governor Snyder came in, and clearly he has some different priorities. And we have Governor Snyder came in and on a positive action message. And the first thing he did was cut education and give tax breaks to big corporations and tax seniors' pensions. So we have clearly been disappointed on some of those actions. But I will say that we're working on our jobs agenda, and we're looking forward to working with anyone who wants to work with us on that agenda.
Is he anti-union?
I can't answer that. I can only say that we have been disappointed in some of his actions. I can say this. He and we do agree with him on this, that he has said that right to work is not on his agenda, and it's not something that we should be doing in Michigan, and that we should be focusing on jobs. And so, you know, I'm hoping to work with him on creating jobs.
Is the debate itself about right to work and ending compulsory union membership, is the debate itself damaging to the state's ability to attract a good workforce?
I think the debate is divisive, and it has nothing to do with creating jobs. Right to work states have lower wages and benefits across the board, and lots of other unattractive characteristics: higher rates of uninsured, higher rates of uninsured children. And so we're interested in working on a real jobs agenda, and not spending time on things that, you know, aren't going to result in job creation.
Has there been too much of a, you know, do you think that the AFL has been tried to work too much with the governor in the past year since he's been in office? I mean, do you see yourself being a little bit more confrontational, or a little bit, you know, pushing back a little harder? Or pushing for the things you want a little harder?
We're going to push for the things that we want. We have a jobs agenda. We want to see investment in schools and children. We want to see growth in clean tech jobs. We want to stop spending tax dollars on jobs in other states for work that could be done here in Michigan. And we want to protect working families in the middle class. So we're going to continue to work on that agenda. We're going to work with anyone that is willing to work with us and shares those goals.
I think to Kathy's question.
Yeah. Does that mean working with the governor more, though, or working less with the governor?
We would love to work more.
But as a practical matter, do you think you have to present a stronger counterpoint to what you've seen out of the executive office?
Well, I think we need to stay on a path toward job creation. That's what's important to Michigan's families. That's what's important to Michigan's working men and women. There's a job crisis in this state, and that's what we're going to stay on.
I don't want to psychoanalyze your answer, but let me try anyway, okay? You refuse to answer the question, he's anti-union. That was on purpose because you don't want to send that signal, do you?
I'm not going to make an assessment of what the governor's views are on unionism.
Well, others in this field have. I mean, they've made a career out of beating up on this guy.
Well, yes, there are some that have beat up on him, but I'm saying we don't agree with his priorities. There are some things that we do agree with him on the right to work issue, and that is one of them.
Well, plenty of your membership thinks that the new emergency manager law is an attempt to bust unions, period. Well, do you agree with that?
The emergency manager law is bad for democracy. It's certainly bad for collective bargaining, which is a powerful problem-solving tool that employers and workers ought to be using to solve problems, especially problems that are at the crisis stage. Just look at the auto industry and what they did using collective bargaining to solve issues there. Over the last several rounds of negotiations, they've made major gains, and it's a tool that ought to be used. And when you put in place an alternate process that, you know, is bad for democracy and is bad for collective bargaining, it takes the stakeholders out of the problem solving, and we need to leave the stakeholders
in
the problem
solving. The dynamic is different there. If they didn't give up, their company goes out of business, they lose jobs. Governments don't go out of business.
Well,
so making, you know, getting concessions is tougher.
Well, but keeping the stakeholders involved and pushing toward the solutions is where we should be.
You know, we saw last year a whole lot of protests. We saw the Occupy movement. We saw thousands of people showing up at the state capitol to protest. Similar things went on in some of Michigan's larger cities. Do you expect to see a continuation of that in 2012, or was that just so last year?
No, I expect to see a continuation of the people of Michigan holding their elected officials accountable. And I think that's what those demonstrations that you described in 2011 were about. We're going to there's grassroots activism building all over the state, and I expect to see it to continue.
Will we see more
demonstrations then?
Well, it's hard to say. We're going to hold elected officials accountable.
Do you think, it's a perception question, do you think that there is a disconnect in the public mind about what a union worker is, blue collar versus white collar, for example?
Well, I think that there are broad perceptions about what unions are and what workers are, but face it, unions are collectives of workers who are stepping up and speaking in their own best interest, and it's an opportunity for workplace democracy where workers are able to elect representatives, they're able to vote on collective bargaining agreements where they are sharing in both decisions about the business, but in their, what comes back to them out of their contributions to that business. And that's good for everybody.
What do you think of the Tea Party movement?
I think they're doing what they believe in, and I think that I don't share their priorities, but you know, that's part of what democracy looks like too.
Well, has it been damaging to unions?
I think what's been damaging to unions has been the job crisis. You know, we have lost too many jobs, and we need to be working on getting back on creating jobs, and I think that's where working people want to see work go in.
We had an incident here recently where a state senator had referred to a female lobbyist as a hooker. And, you know, you're a woman in that milieu now. You're heading up a large organization that, quite frankly, has a lot of unions that are mostly male-centered. And, I mean, what do you see when you're at the Capitol? I mean, do you think that there's an attitude there that's somewhat sexist? Is it something that you run into that you worry about, or in your own organization?
I think that was an unfortunate incident and an inappropriate comment. But I think again, it's another thing that distracts us from focusing on what is really important to be focusing on in Michigan right now, and that is in working on jobs.
What lessons did you learn by watching your predecessor over the last 12 years? Stuff not to do.
Well, I think that there have. There's a lot of lessons to be learned from my predecessor. In fact, he was in the job for 12 years, and I ask him for advice all the time. But I think that this is about listening to the men and women in Michigan, listening to the constituents in the AFL, and then advancing what's in the best interest. And that's what we've been doing.
That was
our jobs, and that's our jobs plan.
What do you think the AFL could do better?
I think what the AFL is doing and is going to continue to do is to stand up for working men and women and do things like lead on building activism around holding elected officials accountable and promote positive agendas for Michigan.
Do you support recalls?
Haven't supported recalls, no.
Why not? That's holding people accountable, isn't it?
It is holding people accountable, but there's... you have to make choices, and the priority is to work on jobs right now.
But I think what he's asking is philosophically, are you opposed to the idea of recalling somebody because you don't agree with a vote they made?
Well, we have decided that we're going to spend our time working on what is important. The philosophical question of whether or not I individually support recalls, I don't think is particularly relevant here. I think what's relevant is the issues that we need to be working on.
So you think they're a waste of time?
I think that they can be a distraction from the work of putting forth an agenda for jobs.
So if the MEA had called you 6 months ago and said, will you join us, try to recall Paul Scott, you'd have said no thanks.
Well, at that time, I was working with the We Are the People table, and the table made a decision not to go down that path. That we're going to work on jobs.
So that was a mistake by the MEA to do that.
I'm not second guessing the MEA.
Well, you don't have to. Did they make a mistake?
There's a need, as I said, to hold legislators accountable, and there's a need to balance some power in Lansing, and part of balancing that power is winning back the House in 2012. And so to the extent that you advance toward that goal, I suppose you're going in the right direction.
Yeah, but you were uncomfortable with all that.
Well, Like I said, we made the coalition that I was working with at the time made a decision that we were going to work on other things.
Has the president disappointed you in any way?
You know, I think the president has done a very good job. I think one thing for Michigan that he has done that we need to remember is the auto rescue, that he not only supported the auto rescue, that he led on the auto rescue.
I understand, but has he disappointed you?
Had we not done that, we wouldn't have an auto industry today like we do.
How tough a sell is he in Michigan? How hard does he have to work to make sure that Michigan remains a blue state in the presidential election?
Well, I think you don't have to look very far down the list of Republican candidates to see that they're not acceptable. Mitt Romney is completely unacceptable. And so I think the contrast is going to be very, very clear.
So you don't expect Michigan to be a battleground state?
Well, I expect there to be a lot of activity in Michigan next year or this year.
Can I ask once more, what has he done anything that disappointed you?
I would say that on balance he's done a very good job for working men and women.
Okay, thank you, Madam President. I don't think that was an answer. Will you give me one after the show? Maybe.
We might.
All right. Thanks for joining us on our show. Also, our thanks
thank
to Chris
you.
And Kathy and Mr. Pluta. Don't forget our email address otr@wkar.org. See you next week, guys.
Production of Off the Record is made possible in part by a grant from Truscott Rossman, Michigan's only bipartisan strategic communications firm, serving statewide, national, and international clients from their offices in Lansing, Detroit, and Grand Rapids. TruscottRossman.com. By the Michigan Food and Beverage Association, in conjunction with the Michigan Business and Professional Association, working together for its members. Membership information on the web at mishbusiness.org. And by Hager Fox Heating and Air Conditioning Company, providing comfort to mid-Michigan homes and businesses since 1941. Hager Fox and Bryant, for whatever it takes, on the web at hagerfox.com. Off the Record with Tim Skubick is available for instant viewing as video download, or you can purchase a copy for your video library. For more information, visit wkar.org.
Michigan Public TV stations have contributed to the production costs of Off the Record with Tim Skubick.